Hi everybody, welcome to episode 23 of the Pins and Needles podcast. My name is Zoe. You can find me on Ravelry and on Instagram. I'll put all my contact details up here on the screen. Welcome back to any returning viewers and a big welcome to my new subscribers. Thank you for spending some time with me today. Today is Saturday, the 1st of April, so I hope nobody's played any nasty, jokes on you. April Fool's Day tends to miss my children because they never know what the date is, so I've got away with it so far, but it's only about 10 o'clock in the morning, so we'll see. There's still time. First of all, I wanted to say, if I'm sounding a little bit odd, it's because I am recovering from a rather nasty bout of tonsillitis. It's something that I get quite regularly, and I've pretty much had it for a week, and I'm just at the very tail end of it. I'm still very bunged up and things, so I have a large box of man-sized tissues and a glass of water, and I will do my best not to sneeze, cough, or blow my nose during this podcast, but you may have to bear with me if I have a sudden explosion. I'm also recording on my laptop this week. Thank you all so much, by the way, for being so kind about my technical issues last week. Apparently, the bit of the last episode where I showed you the yarn that I bought actually came out in colour. Thank goodness. That was the only bit that really I wanted you to be able to see properly. So thank you all very much. Lots of you took the time to say, oh, don't worry, it was still interesting and, you know, it happens to us all. So I did feel a bit better about it after that. I still haven't managed to quite sort out what's going on. That needs time and money, which are both in a bit short supply at the moment. So I'm back on the laptop. Hopefully this will be better than grey, washed out videos. And I will try to try and work out what it is. I don't know what the problem is. Is it my phone? Is it the laptop? Is it the video card? I just have no idea. So in terms of how my last 2 weeks have been, as I said, much illness, which has not been a great deal of fun. I decided to try and spend a bit of quality time with all of my kids. I have three children, and trying to fit in time with each of them individually is very difficult, but I managed it. I took Jocelyn to go and see Beauty and the Beast. I don't know if you've managed to get to the cinema yet to see that, but it was really good fun. The songs are amazing, the costumes were gorgeous, and we really enjoyed it. Max, my youngest boy, got a free football ticket from the school. Our local town is very small. It was just a local league match. It was Barry Town against Ely, which is a suburb of Cardiff. And yeah, they give the local primary schools some free tickets, and Max really wanted to go. It was a nice sunny day, but it was so windy, and I was really only one day out of bed after my tonsillitis. So I wrapped myself up to the nostrils in coats and woolly shawls and things like that, and took Max to the football. We bought a tray of chips and two great big cups of hot chocolate and sat through the match. I've never seen a football match live, so I quite enjoyed the first half. They really are skilled, even at this level. But because I don't fully understand the rules, after the first half, it was basically just men running around kicking a ball, so my attention did wander. But Max had a hoot. Some of his other school friends were there, so they were playing a bit of football along the sidelines. I haven't quite got round to doing something with Conrad, my eldest, struck down with allergy and things like that, but it's his birthday next month, so I think he's going to have some time with his dad. He and Dave are going to go up to Birmingham to the NEC. There's a big gaming conference on Insomnia, I think it is, so they can have some man computer time, which will be good. Work on the house has had a little break. I've managed to get through quite a bit more of the cleaning, so it's starting to look a bit more functional. And the roof has turned up. We've had a leak in our roof for quite a while, and one of the Velux windows has started leaking. So I thought, well, in for a penny, in for a pound, keep going, get it all done. but my house is a three-storey house, so you have to have scaffolding. And the weather in Wales has been disgusting. It's been gale force, sideways rain and wind, and obviously you can't be up a roof in weather like that, whether it's scaffolding or on ladders. Anyway, so the scaffolders have been, and the roof has started yesterday, so one half of my roof is now waterproof, and hopefully they'll be back today to do the other side. So that would be nice if I can get that done. And then in the middle of all of that, my fridge packed up. I really don't want to have to spend £200 on another fridge, but I think I have to. I can't save it. And because I've had no sense of smell with my cold, I haven't been able to tell when anything's gone off. So it's really been a bit touch and go, but I don't seem to have poisoned anybody. I'm calling that a win. I will order a new one, but I haven't done it yet. I have an exciting announcement to make next. There's a new knit-along that's going to be taking place in my group and in the Owl About Yarn group and in the Tyddyn Bryn group. You know that me, Ellie and Jennie are thick as thieves. I've started referring to us as the Three Musketeers. So we decided that we would do a joint knit-along. We're going to call it the Three Amigas Cal, and that will be the hashtag that we use for Instagram as well. And I will put all of the details in the chat thread, which is going to be hosted in my group. The finished objects thread is going to be hosted in Jennie's Owl About Yarn group. And the prize drawing thread will be hosted in Ellie's Tyddyn Bryn group. The rules are as follows. You have to be a member of all three groups. The dates, it starts today, the 1st of April, and it finishes on the 31st of May. It's knitting and crochet only, no whips, and your finished object must be a minimum of 200 yards or 200 metres. I'm not bothered about the difference there. You need to be a member of all three groups, and we were sort of trying to go with a spring fling theme. So either springy coloured yarn, or if you're thinking of doing a garment, you know, a lighter weight garment, or maybe the sort of yarn you're using, like a cotton or a linen blend. Again, we're fairly loose on it, but some sort of springy knitted or crocheted object. I will put all of the details in the show notes, along with timestamps and links to the other Ravelry groups as well. And later on, I'll show you what I'm going to make for my contribution to that. So I really enjoyed the last knit along, and you guys seem to as well. So have a think. You've got 2 months, and come and join us in the knit along. We will each of us be donating a prize, but we haven't quite decided what that will be yet. I did make it to knit night this week, as did Ellie and Jennie, but for some reason we didn't quite get round to talking about the knit-along details. We've just been messaging each other backwards and forwards in our Facebook group. So we'll thrash out the details of the prizes a bit later on, but we'll let you know, obviously. I think mine will probably be a skein of yarn from my stash. I think it will probably be a skein of Wollmeister. I have a lovely red skein of Wollmeister that I've had for years and not knitted up. So maybe one of you guys could give it a better home. We'll see. But stay tuned. Pause for one moment while I cough. I beg your pardon. Ooh. Right. That's a bit better. I'm afraid there is still no pins section this week. I've been wiped out literally for the last 7 days with this illness, and I haven't managed to dig any of my sewing stuff back out, but I will. I promise I will. On the plus side, if I move swiftly and seamlessly onto needles, I do have some finished objects to show you. First up are my dad's Christmas socks. I've showed you these before. I think I was halfway down the second sock, something like that. This is just a plain vanilla sock. It's my standard dad sock recipe, 80 stitches on 2.25 millimeter needles. And I knit these magic loop on my Addy lace, whatever the ones with the red cables, it's that one. The contrast cuffs, heels and toes are in some random Regia grey yarn, don't know the colourway. And then the body of the socks is Opal, there we go, Der Kleine Prinz. And the colourway is 7765. Yeah. Oh, and thank you to the viewer. On the last time I mentioned these socks, I said it's in German. I don't know if that's the colourway. But yes, Farber does mean colourway. So thank you very much for confirming that. So yes, I can now tuck these away, all ready for Christmas. I was getting a bit fed up with knitting them. I always do. The feet are just enormously long. But mostly I don't enjoy magic loop very much. And I do have to use that for vanilla socks because I get terrible ladders. I have tried, I like DPNs is my favourite way to knit socks. But like I said, I get ladders. I've tried using 5 DPNs to knit socks, still get ladders. I've tried really pulling tight on the second stitch on the needle, still get ladders. So I don't know, if any of you have any tips other than those two things that I could try, I would really appreciate it because I don't enjoy magic loop. It's so much faffing about, pulling and hoiking and shoving, and then you get those weird bunny ears at the end and they flip round and you end up lassoing yourself to your own knitting. It really makes me cross. Anyway, socks. Very pleased to have those off my needles. Next up, I finished my Hitchhiker. I'm a bit slow to catch on to knitting project hot topics. You know, suddenly everyone's knitting something. Well, I usually come to these things about 3 years late. So in about 2020, expect to see me knitting my Find Your Fade. Anyway, I'm sure you all know the pattern. This is Hitchhiker by Martina Behm. It's a paid for pattern on Ravelry, and I'll include links down below. I knitted this in some of Jennie's yarn when I helped her out at the Wonderwool Yarn Show last April. My wages was any 2 skeins I wanted off the stand, and unfortunately we'd sold out of the ones I was aching for. Jennie dyed up so much yarn, and she dyed up 5 skeins of each colourway, and all 5 of this one went, and Jennie said, don't worry, I'll dye you up some more. So I was quite happy to wait until she fired up her dye pots. Anyway, so this is the Hitchhiker. It's a long, shallow shawl. I haven't woven in the ends. I haven't managed to get round to blocking it yet, unfortunately. I normally put my blocking mats out on the spare bed because I can leave it till it dries, and the Velux window gets the sunshine coming right through it, so it dries quite quickly. But Jocelyn is sleeping in there at the moment, so I'm a bit stuck. Now, I'm particularly thrilled by the yarn and pattern combination. Every now and then, it's a match made in heaven, and it really is with this one. So it's All About Yarn, in the colourway, she did tell me, Bonfire Night. And it's basically a black and charcoal with colours in. And the way it has worked with this is absolutely perfect. You get these dashes of colour all the way up. And then every now and then, the colour bits end on the teeth edges. So I'm absolutely thrilled with this. It's nice and long, and I wanted it to wear to Wonderwool. So we're going up again. Wonderwool is, I think, the 21st and 22nd of this month. I'll be up there helping Jennie on the stall, and I like to have a shawl made in her yarn to wear. Wonderwool takes place at the Royal Showground in Bilth Wells, and it's basically cattle sheds. They hose all the dung off the floor and put all of these stands up, and it's very breezy, very cold, even if it's actually warm weather, it's often very cold inside and you're not moving around very much. You're on your feet constantly, but you do get really cold. So this is what I knitted, and it's going to be spot on. Now it's garter, so it will open out once I have blocked it, but it's long enough that you can tie a knot in the bottom and it will work out quite nicely. So yeah, I might just wear it even with the dangly bits. So that is my Hitchhiker shawl. I'm thrilled with it. I used a 3.5mm needle, which is a little bit bigger than the pattern suggests, but that's because I couldn't be bothered to get up and find a different needle size. I think it's in another project bag somewhere and I couldn't find it, so I went with a 3.5mm needle. I'm quite a tight knitter, so that actually was going to work in my favour. I had plenty of yarn. I had two skeins. I knitted it until I had 42 teeth. Hitchhiker 42, ring any bells? And I needed to break into the second skein for the last two points. But I've probably got, well, I've got the vast majority of the second skein left. So that will probably become socks with contrast cuffs, heels and toes. I did have another finished object to show you. I knitted a hat. I took it with me to Edinburgh and got some work done on that out of scrappy yarn. And it was a hat for my youngest son, Max, but he's worn it to school every day and to bed since I cast it off. And typically he left it in his locker at school on Friday, so I can't show you that. But if I can get him to bring it home, he would like to come on the podcast and model it for you. So if you can hang on till next episode, there will be a cameo by my smallest boy modelling his latest hat. On to my works in progress. First of all, I'm going to show you what my knit along, my Three Amigas knit along project is going to be. And this project has had, in a way, a bit of a bumpy start. I don't know if you remember, but a while ago, a very lovely viewer bought me a copy of the Angelus Novus cardigan pattern. It's a pattern by Renee Callahan, and again, it's available on Ravelry. And I was really looking forward to knitting this. I wanted a sort of an open-fronted DK weight cardigan for spring. I had the yarn already, and I thought this would be fantastic. It's an interesting construction. Again, I think I've mentioned it before. You do a garter tab cast on at the bottom, and then you knit it like a shawl, and then you do magic to make it into a cardigan. I can't give away the details because it's a paid for pattern. And it says DK weight yarn. Fabulous. It doesn't mean DK weight yarn. It means Aran weight yarn. It uses a particular, I think it's Blacker Swan DK that the pattern suggests. And when I sat down to actually do a tension square, I realised that the pattern said this DK weight yarn works up more like an Aran weight. And it was supposed to be knit on 5.5mm needles, so I thought, well, I'll give it a whirl with my yarn, which is a standard DK, and there wasn't a prayer. It was never going to work, and I was so disappointed because the construction is fascinating. It was a gift from a viewer, and it wasn't going to work. So I found an alternative, which I'm sure you've all heard of, and it is the Vitamin D cardigan pattern by Heidi, Kerrmaier. I've forgotten where the camera is on this. So you can see it's got the waterfall front and sort of 3/4 length sleeves, and there's eyelet details in it. There's a rather nice schematic actually, which will probably, yes, there we go. So there's the schematic. So you can wear it open or you could fix it with a shawl pin. So that was my alternative, and it did mean I got to use the yarn I wanted to use. I haven't got terribly far because obviously I couldn't cast on for the actual garment until today. I did do some tension square knitting. I know in you know, in America, everyone calls it a gauge square. I prefer the British tension square because, my goodness, it can be really tense trying to get the right number of stitches and rows per inch. Anyway, I was feeling pretty disgusting with my tonsillitis and I couldn't brain anything complicated. So I thought, knit yourself a tension square, love, and see how it goes. So that is my tension square. It's a purpley mauve colour, which is one of my most favourite colours. There's the yarn in the ball. And I've got about 12 balls of this, so really I should have enough. And it is Sublime Extra Fine Merino Wool DK in the excitingly named shade 20229. There's the ball band. So it's a commercial yarn. It's a very lovely colour. I'm very much looking forward to casting it on. I think it's a top down. Yeah, the cardigan is worked top down in one piece. So it's still, you know, a fun construction, not too much making up to do at the end. So I need to wash and block my tension square. I might have a blocking party, get my hitchhiker done, get my tension square done, and then I can get cracking on that. Excuse me. I'm trying so hard not to sniff. Okay. Oh, and my other work in progress. No, it's no good. I'm sorry. I'm going to have to just blow my nose a bit. Oh, I beg your pardon. Right. My next work in progress is my current obsession. I mentioned previously that I'd knit those socks on Magic Loop. And I'm fed up with it. I'm fed up with Magic Loop. So I desperately wanted something that I could knit on double-pointed needles. And I wanted some socks for me. So this is my latest sock project. This is the Prarie Socks by Kay Jones of the Bakery Bears. It's a fairly newly released pattern. And it's absolutely stunning. It's a very simple pattern. It's a paid for pattern, so I can't give anything away. But you can see it's a very simple twisted stitch pattern. And it reminds me of the Hermione's Everyday. You know, the Hermione's Everyday socks by Erica Luder. And those are just the right combination of mindless but not boring. So there's just enough to do. And I'm knitting this on some one-of-a-kind yarn that Ellie dyed for me, Tyddyn Bryn yarns. I'll show you the ball. I don't know if you remember, but I'd already knitted a coop knit sock in this yarn and it didn't fit, so I had to rip the whole thing out and I was really disappointed, and I've been looking for a pattern to knit with this yarn ever since. And it's such a pretty shade. It's sort of violets and very, the colour's blowing out a bit, violets and very pale blues, and it's tonal, so it doesn't obscure the pattern. There you are, look at that. And I don't like, when I'm using double pointed needles, I don't like using a stitch marker on my needle for the start of the round. So I just add a progress keeper, basically. And I know that when I can see the progress keeper, that's needle number one. And this is one that I bought from Jennie. And it's full of sparkly crystals. And I just felt like it really went nicely. So I'm knitting these on 2.25 millimeter needles. These are my carbons, Knit Picks carbons, which I would prefer straight smooth metal, but I am a tight knitter, so I do tend to bend them. So I go with carbons. They're a little bit grabbier than I would like, but I'm more than prepared to live with that. I've got as far as the heel flap, and just for once, I'm being good and following the pattern. Normally, I just plug the stitch pattern into my standard sock recipe, but this has an eye of partridge heel, which I've never done. It's not difficult. I've always done slip stitch heel flaps, but this is the Eye of Partridge one. Although I have to say, you can't quite see the Eye of Partridge-ness. It's not quite coming out, but it doesn't matter. Slip stitch is fine. So I'm really enjoying these. It's been a while since I've knitted socks for me. So that is my current favourite whip. And yeah, back on double pointed needles, which is absolutely lovely. Ooh, acquisitions. Dramatic pause for a drink. It was my birthday at the beginning of March, and I had a lovely present from my friend Jennie. Hi Jennie, if you're watching. If you remember, I knitted two sausage dogs just before Christmas and just in the new year for Jennie's little boy Sammy. He was obsessed with a particular storybook that had sausage dogs in, and she couldn't find any to buy him for Christmas. So she asked me if I'd knit some up, and I did. I really enjoyed making them. We've been friends for donkey's years, and we're sort of a bit old for buying each other birthday presents, but she very kindly sent me a parcel of presents, more as a thank you for knitting these sausage dogs. And luckily for me, Jennie has fantastic taste. First of all, she bought me this little stamp set, and I think these are from Tiger. So you get four stamps, and they say made with love, handmade by, homemade, and I did it my way. Look at those. Aren't those fun? So I can, put those on labels when I gift people things. And also from Tiger, some ribbon that says, this took me hours to make. Is it going to show with hearts on? So I might use that for presents, or I might use that as a drawstring in a project bag. Yes, that's Tiger as well. And also some flower head pins. You can never have too many pins. And I've not had any like these. These have got flat heads on them. All the ones that I've got have got the traditional ball head glass tops. But these are completely flat. Look at that. So when I'm hemming things, that's going to be much easier because I can just iron straight over the top. So thank you, Jennie. Those are lovely. But the most amazing thing she bought me was this. Knitted Animal Cozies by Fiona Goble. And this is a foxy hot water bottle cover. There's so many fun things in here. So it's 35 cute and easy designs for animal-themed cozies. And interestingly, my dad very rarely asks me to make him anything except socks. He loves the socks. But he did want me to make him an egg cozy. He likes hard-boiled eggs for breakfast. Not hard-boiled eggs. Boiled eggs for breakfast. And he always makes himself two. And the other one's gone a little bit cold by the time he gets round to it. But look, I could knit a chicken egg cozy. Oh, this is such a fun book. Look at these. Oh, and I thought this would be quite good for stash busting, you know, little scraps and things like that. So thank you, Jennie. You're a star. That's a lovely book. I haven't made anything from it yet, but I really ought to knit those egg cozies. I also bought myself some books from Amazon. Excuse me. I haven't had a stitch dictionary for quite a while. A few years ago I had a copy of Barbara Walker, the first one with the blue cover on it, but I gave that away to a friend of mine, and he's had lots of use out of it since, so that's absolutely fine. But as I mentioned last week, I am dipping my toes into the designing world. I've had a couple of ideas, and I needed some materials and resources to help me. And I had a word with Jennie, and I said, do you have any stitch dictionaries that I could have a look at? Because there's so many, and I know you can read the reviews on Amazon, but it's not quite the same as having a look. And I don't have a bookshop near me that would sell anything like this. So Jennie very kindly emptied her knitting bookshelves into a tote bag and heaved them all the way to the San Martin for knit night so I could have a look. She let me take them home with me so I could have a really good flick through. And basically, I've ended up buying 3 out of the 4 stitch dictionaries that she lent me. I did put a picture of these up on Instagram, and I'll link down below all the details of it. So the first one is this. Oh, camera. It's Cast On, Bind Off. And it is by Leslie Ann Bestor. And the first thing to note about this book, it's spiral bound, which is perfect. So you can lay it out flat on your lap. And it's absolutely fascinating. I'm not usually one for reading technique books completely dry. I use them as a reference book. So when I need to use them, I pick them up for a project, find what I need, and then I put them down. These I've read almost cover to cover. They're just fascinating. So she covers a lot of the standards like Judy's Magic Cast On, but also some fantastic ones like Tilly Buddy's Very Stretchy Cast On. And there's very clear photographs. It's really well laid out. I'll show you the Judy's Magic Cast On, just so you can get a feel for the layout. There you are, look. And if I have a look at the... Yeah. The way she's designed it, she's separated it out. So if you have a look at the contents page, part one is cast-ons, and she's separated them out into basic, stretchy, decorative, circular, double-sided, multicolour, provisional, tubular, and Mobius. So if you've got a particular project and it says you need a stretchy cast-on, you can go straight to the section of this book, and then there'll be a selection there for you to use. She's done a similar thing with the bind-offs. That's sorted into basic, stretchy, decorative, and sewn. So yes, it wasn't terribly expensive. I think it cost me £11 from Amazon. We have Amazon Prime, so I got the delivery for free. And the other one was Increase Decrease by Judith Durant. So it's exactly the same format, spiral bound, sits flat. And they're a nice little size. It's the same size as my head. So it'll fit in your knitting bag if you want to take it with you. And again, fantastic clear photographs. I'm just having a look. And the way she does explanations as well. I'm trying to find a page to show you without giving anything away. So there's lovely clear instructions and photos. And then when she's explaining the difference in appearance of various techniques, she's got photographs of lots of little swatches. So you can actually see, you can do a compare and contrast is what I'm trying to say. So like this one. So again, really nice book. It'll sit nice and flat on your lap. And again, nicely organised. So she's sorted the increases into neutral increases, right and left leaning, multiple stitch, centred doubles. And again, the same with the decreases. And she also covers, she has a section called combinations in special circumstances. So increases and decreases for decorative effect, and then special circumstances being texture patterns, lace patterns and colour patterns. I've read the whole thing, it's fascinating. So I really think that that would be an excellent addition, along with the cast-on bind-off. I think, actually, that reminds me, Jennie sent me a link to the Knit Picks website, and a couple of days ago, these were on sale. So if you do have some spare money burning a hole in your pocket, that might be worth looking at. So I also needed a stitch dictionary, and when I was thinking about designing, I've got a collection of designs in my brain. Some of them are going to be knit in the round, and some of them are going to be knit flat. And even if I'd still had my Barbara Walker, they're all just knit flat patterns. But Jennie had this up, down, all around stitch dictionary by Wendy Bernard. Bernard Bernard. I'm not sure which one. So this is a collection of stitch patterns, and as the title suggests, she lays them out for you, written flat, and written in the round, and top down, and bottom up. Absolute genius. Again, spiral bound. Perfect. Thank you very much. It does include a small number of patterns as well, but that's not really the point. And again, separated nicely into chunks. So there's knits and purls, ribs, textured, slipped and fancy, yarn overs and eyelets, cables, lace, colourwork, hems and edgings. And she also has a bit of an explanatory bit at the beginning about how to swap stitch patterns out and change things around. So, just trying to give you a bit of an idea. So here's an example. Oh, there's the Roman stripe, and she's giving you instructions for in the flat and in the round. So I think that's absolute genius. And as I was flicking through Jennie's copy, I immediately found three stitch patterns that I thought I wanted to use in some of my designs. So I bought myself this. I think this was about £20, something like that. Again, not cheap, but not that expensive. I don't think Barbara Walker's would be any cheaper. And the amount of time it will save you, you know, if you're a top-down sock knitter, but you fall in love with a toe-up sock pattern and they don't give you both options, it can take quite a bit of time to try and work out how to transpose the stitch pattern. So I think this is a really, really good idea. Beautiful quality book, hardcover. So yeah, I ordered all three of the same books and I think they will be really useful indeed. The last acquisition was a present, and it was a gift to me from Ellie. Now, I don't know if you've heard of Tracy of Thimble and Thread Make. She is a bag maker on Etsy, and she also has a lovely podcast. You must go and find her on YouTube. She's such a lovely lady and makes beautiful things, and she's just a nice, soothing companion. I really enjoy that. Anyway, she has been making Harry Potter project bags. Excuse me. Now, apparently Harry Potter fabric can be quite hard to come by in this country, so she'd ordered some special fabric in from America, which is quite pricey. And of course, it sold out in seconds, because who doesn't love Harry Potter? So she managed to source a little bit more and did some pre-orders. Oh, my voice is going, I do apologise. And Ellie managed to snag three pre-orders, and she pre-ordered the same bag for each of us. And it was a complete surprise. And here is the Harry Potter Thimble and Thread bag. It's these cute characters. Look at Snape and his grumpy face. And we've got Luna with her glasses on for seeing Nargles. And there's Hagrid and Broomsticks and Dobby and everything. I absolutely love them. It's got a nice handle and it's a drawstring. And it's just the right size. I've got my Prarie sock in here. So I've got a ball of sock yarn and half a sock. And it fits absolutely perfectly. And I love the toggles on the top of drawstrings. And it's, I don't know if it's interfaced or not, but it's sturdy enough to sit nicely. But you can scrunch it down and stick it in your handbag, which is exactly what I did the other day. And I was knitting on the train on the way home. So, a huge thank you to Ellie. I'm absolutely tickled pink with it. And a big thank you to Tracy of Thimble and Thread Make as well, because it really is stunning. You know what I'm like about checking the corners. Look at the corners, they're spot on. So yes, I will leave links to Tracy's shop down below. And if you're looking for a project bag, I don't think she's got any more of these. I think they did all go, but she does have some other designs that are just as beautiful. So do go and check her out. That is the end of my acquisitions. I think that's quite a few, and I'm absolutely thrilled with the books that I've got, and I will be knitting a chicken egg cozy as soon as I can. One last drink to get me through the last section. The last thing I wanted to talk to you about was Two's Company. Two's Company is my little bit of the podcast where I point you in the direction of other podcasts or particular videos or audio podcasts, just to give you a bit of a heads up on what I've been watching and listening to and things that I think you might like. First up, have you heard of Christy Glass Knits? I think you probably have. She's quite popular, but she's quite new to me. I think the Grocery Girls mentioned it and I went and had a look. Her knitting podcast is, it feels a bit different. She's an American lady and it's not a normal chat podcast like this one. She has different shorter segments and sort of quite a fun bit that's sort of the knitting news, so it's quite a different feel. But what I wanted to recommend to you was her series of interviews. She's done a series of chats with male knitters. It's called Manch, M-A-N-C-H, and I think there's an in-joke in there, but I'm not part of it. I don't know, excuse me, where that came from. But she has interviewed some fascinating people, absolutely fascinating, and I have so enjoyed watching them, and I wanted to let you know. She's interviewed Nathan of the Sockmatician podcast, who I'm sure you've all heard of, Sam Barksy. Have you heard of Sam Barksy? He was all over Ravelry and Instagram, and he's the gentleman that knits jumpers, beautiful jumpers, with places of interest on them. Of course, I can't think of any off the top of my head, but he would knit a landscape from a city he'd visited, and then he would go there and stand in front of the building that he'd knitted into his jumper and take a picture. Does that ring a bell? I haven't managed to watch that one yet, but it's next on my list. She had a really good interview with Eric Lutz of the Sticks Plus Twine podcast, and I've been watching him for a while, but it was fascinating to find out how he got into knitting, what it means to him as a male knitter, and also a bit more information on setting up his Rib magazine, which he does with Devon of Handmade and Woolen podcast. She also has an interview with Josh Reichs, the shawl knit designer as well. So do go and find those. Fascinating series of interviews, and I think you'll enjoy her other episodes as well. The other thing I wanted to give you a heads up about was episode 25 of the Fruity Knitting podcast. I forgot to mention Andrew and Andrea last time. I met Andrew at Edinburgh Yarn Festival. He's an absolute sweetheart. And they have, again, a slightly different knitting podcast. It's very professionally produced. It looks really, really high quality. And Andrea does, again, lots of interesting interviews. And episode 25 had a discussion with a lady called Gail Rome. I hope I pronounced that right, who is a particular expert in Japanese knitting. So she talks about some of the history of Japanese knitting, where it is at the moment with modern day knitwear designers and things like that. And she also talks you through some garments that typify the Japanese modern style, and also some tips and tricks on how to knit using a Japanese knitting pattern if you don't speak or read Japanese yourself. So again, it was really interesting, really unusual, different topic. So do watch episode 25 of the Fruity Knitting podcast. In terms of sewing, I have mentioned Helen of Stitch My Style before. Her podcast, always good fun. But she's starting a new series of blog posts, and she set herself a challenge of reproducing classic dresses from Hollywood. She's quite skilled, she's good at designing her own clothes as well, so she's trying to push her skills by recreating iconic dresses. And she started with the Marilyn Monroe's cream dress with all the pleats in the skirt, you know, where she's standing over that fan heater and it all goes whoosh up in the air. So I think she's done that over a series of 3 vlogs and it's now finished, but it really is fascinating to watch how she starts with a flat piece of fabric and a photograph and ends up with this beautiful dress. And what was also interesting was that when she was trying to get all the pleats in the fabric, she decided to go to get that done professionally. So there's a couple of minutes clip of how a professional fabric pleater works with all the cardboard layers and things like that. So do go and watch that. Stitch My Style, Making the Marilyn Dress, and there's 3 episodes of that. And one more series of vlogs I wanted to recommend. Sewing Vintage with Tara Moss. It's a relatively new podcast. Tara Moss is an Australian lady who is obviously particularly into vintage fashion. She's also a speaker, particularly to do with women's rights and social media. So she's a fascinating woman, very intelligent, very beautiful. And she's just done a series of vlogs on making a corset. I'm not sure that, of course, I will ever wear a corset, but it was fascinating to watch. And again, it's well produced. It looks beautiful and a really interesting topic. So I will leave links to all of those down below. And hopefully one or two of them will pique your interest and maybe give you a new podcaster to go and watch. That is all I've got to share with you today. I apologise again for the state of my voice and the nose blowing halfway through. I hope you'll forgive me. Please remember to give me a thumbs up and click subscribe if you enjoyed the episode. Don't forget about the Three Amigas knit along. I will leave links to everything down below. And I will be back in 2 weeks' time with some finished pyjamas. I've said it here. Next episode, pyjama party, okay? I'm going to wear mine. You need to be wearing yours. Okay? Happy crafting. Bye!